And what a great pleasure to have an all-studded star cast here with us in our studios. Sanjay Kumar from CSDS, Yashwant Deshmukh, Rashid Kidwai, Surjit Bhalla, Axis Minders, Pradeep Gupta live with us as well. All people, all pollsters who've come up with their own analysis, with their own take about that signpost. We'll get to know on the 11th which of these individuals has got it right about whether this signpost is going to change or not. Right at the top of the program, let's straight away first go to Anand Narasimhan and get a sense as to what have been the projections that have been made by all these gentlemen here.
Well, Bhupen, the projections have been here to there. They have been all over the place, if some would say. And some people asked me, sir, inka basic sample size kitna tha? This was after all the pollsters had put that out. So, Bhupen, you can ask that. But now, if you look at Madhya Pradesh, the numbers are Times Now, CNX, till Seawater, and the ABP, CSDS, and of course, India Today, Axis. Some of them give the verdict to the BJP. Some of them give it to the Congress party. One of them says it could be dead heat. So we are here to there, all over the place. We are like 116 to win. But if you look at these numbers, it looks like a lot of people believe that the Congress party may just surge slightly ahead of Shivraj Singh Chauhan's BJP in Madhya Pradesh. But we'll see how it turns around. Rajasthan, quickly, if you can call up the numbers for Rajasthan. In Rajasthan, the Congress party, which 2 months ago was running away with the elections, is now quite literally in a dead heat with the BJP. The BJP seems to be playing catch-up towards the last moments. Now, in this case, if you look at it very, very carefully, you have Republic Seawater and the ABP CSDS giving the Congress party runaway numbers. The overall median says that the BJP will fall short. But there are pollsters who still believe that the BJP might just bring a surprise. One or two of them are giving the BJP the edge. But overall, Times Now, CNX, India Today, Axis, ABP, CSDS, and of course the Republic Seawater say it's the Congress all over the way. So there is going to be a change perhaps in that signpost of yours, Bhupen, and ours at that point in time once the results are out. Quickly, as far as Chhattisgarh is concerned, here again, scenarios of dead heat, Congress trying to play catch-up, but Raman Singh may just pull through. So the BJP may just retain this one, is what the indications suggest. Times Now, CNX gives the BJP just the majority number or the halfway number, that is 46. India Today, Axis says no, it's the Congress that gets about 55 seats. But ABP, CSDS and of course Republic Seawater again give the mandate and say that perhaps Raman Singh may just pull it off. The Ajit Jogi factor, as far as the Ajit Jogi JCC combination with Mayawati, how much that comes into influence, with some of them it's not there, but yes, two or three of them are giving them seven seats, and seven seats is critical in that game. Quickly, as far as Telangana is concerned, as we put up the big numbers for Telangana, well, the BJP is nowhere in the fray, but the fight is between the Praja Kutami and TRS, KCR. KCR seems to be the one who should be getting the mandate. It's the Pink Brigade which is going to actually walk away with the numbers this time around, as far as the pollsters are concerned, comfortably. NewsX Neta says he may just fall short. But overall, it's KCR who gets the mandate. So Telangana retained, BJP may lose a state, Congress may pinch. That scorecard, that signpost of ours may change on December 11th. At the moment, as far as this, you know the bigger picture. You can bring that to our viewers, Bhupen.
Okay, so the conclusion is that there is confusion. There is confusion whether the exit pollsters, opinion pollsters, have they given us enough evidence, enough empirical evidence to conclude that this signpost is going to move in a decisive direction in some way. There is one pollster who has decided to stick his neck out this election season. And that pollster says that this signpost actually is going to change away from the Congress party, Surjit Bhalla. Now, Surjit Bhalla, who does a column called No Proof Required, so we wonder whether we can insist on any proof for Mr. Bhalla or not. There he is, smiling. Maybe that's a nervous smile. We'll get to know. But what are Surjit Bhalla's numbers? Let's put up Surjit Bhalla's numbers for you. Dr. Bhalla is predicting a straightforward victory. A straightforward victory for Madhya Pradesh in favor of BJP. There you have those numbers. The Bharatiya Janata Party, according to him, is set for a clean sweep in Madhya Pradesh, which is the next state, Rajasthan. In Rajasthan, where there appears to be a consensus across different polls that we have seen, that Vasundhara Raje may well end up losing. And look at that number. Dr. Bhalla believes Vasundhara Raje is going to come back. in part. Chhattisgarh, it's a small state, becomes even more intriguing with the entry of a third player like the alliance between Ajit Jogi and Mayawati. What does Dr. Balla say? Sweep for the BJP. Straightforward victory in favor of Bharatiya Janata Party. Telangana, newest state. Has the Congress got its story right by tying up with the TDP? Dr. Balla believes no. The Congress said Bahakutami not winning. It's the TRS which is going to win. Bottom line, Surjit Balla believes this is an election for the BJP and this figure of 311 is going to change in favor of the BJP. This one will get removed from the Congress's quota. Surjit Balla, tell me, what is it about your number? Everyone else seems to be in consensus that the BJP has got the story wrong, certainly as far as the state of Rajasthan is concerned. Why do you believe that even in the state of Rajasthan, the story is still in favor of the BJP?
Yeah. First of all, I want to clarify, mine is not an opinion poll. Mine is not an exit poll. So that may explain part of the reason why I get very different results.
What is this? This is a poll? Is this just a charcha?
And it is the swing. Primarily the swing, though there are other elements involved as well. And the swing this time for the other pollsters to be right on Rajasthan has to repeat the swing towards the BJP in 1993, which, if you know, happened after Babri Masjid. Never in India's history, at least since 1980, has such a large swing taken place.
So you are on a principle of mathematics. You believe mathematically it's just not possible. That's the blunt question which you're putting up on the program tonight. Have the exit polls actually got this election right? There are some agencies who ended up doing two polls, and those two polls end up projecting two scenarios. So let me take that question to Sanjay Kumar as well and get him to respond. Sanjay ji, so much of criticism now of the way exit polls, opinion polls are being done. I see that even in your results, there is a huge difference between what you were showing in the run-up to the Madhya Pradesh election and what you're saying now. Does election in India really change so dramatically in the span of a two-month time period?
First, factually, in the pre-poll survey, we mentioned that BJP is ahead of Congress by 2% in Madhya Pradesh. Now we are saying Congress is ahead over BJP by 3%. It's not a huge swing. In a bipolar contest, you just need to swing 3 or 4% votes. And that is what seems to have happened in Madhya Pradesh during a course of 1 month, almost 1 month, because our first pre-poll was conducted in the last week of October and early November. And this poll was conducted at the end of November. So I think I don't see it as a big swing which can never take place in the 4 weeks of campaign.
Yashwant Deshmukh, the story of Madhya Pradesh, I see even in your poll, there is a lot of emphasis which is being made about the presence, the relevance, the importance of Shivraj Singh Chauhan. Is Shivraj Singh Chauhan the most important factor as far as the story of Madhya Pradesh is concerned?
I mean, he is very popular, no doubt about that. I mean, none of the poll, even the polls which have been suggesting that, I mean, we did a tracker for that matter. We were doing a daily tracker for ABP and ran it for almost 3 months. Not a single point of time we ever suggested that Shivraj Singh Chauhan is unpopular. It's not the thing. Thing is that this is not a presidential election. At the end of the day, India is first past the post system.
So
people vote for the sitting for or against the sitting MLA or at the MLA level.
Let me take that to Zaka Jacob. Yeah. Because what you're saying is that this is ultimately about local factors. This is ultimately about who's the MLA. I'm wondering, Zaka, through the election campaign, there was no talk. Prime Minister Modi and Amit Shah were not talking about local MLAs. They were talking about Rahul Gandhi's Gotra and Masjid and etc. I want to understand from you, is Shivraj Singh Chauhan the most important factor this election season?
You know, it's interesting. This is the big picture. This is 2013. And I'm going by what Sanjay ji said. The difference between BJP and Congress in 2013 was 8%. So to get even, to get to 41, both even Stevens 41, Congress needs a plus 4. Now you are saying Congress is leading by plus 3. So what they need from the 2013 position is a plus 7% swing in their favor. That is a huge election. That's a wave. Anyway, be that as it may. Now, let me show you the Shivraj Singh factor. Shivraj Singh factor is critical, and I'm going to divide this between 2013 and 2008. A bulk of the seats, there are 65 out of the 230 seats where Shivraj Singh Chauhan plays a huge role. Bulk of them in the Mahakaushal region. And I want our viewers to pay attention to this. These are a cluster of seats. I'm just going to highlight just the BJP seats. BJP in 2013 won 47 out of those 65 seats. That is a what? 80, almost 90% strike rate. Here's that cluster. This whole bunch of cluster of seats. This is just around the Hoshangabad. This is all Mahakaushal. There's a couple of seats here. There's a couple of seats here. And then in the northern side, around the Vindhya Pradesh area, there's again another half a dozen odd seats. Now watch this. This is 2013. Cut to 2008. It's much more even between Congress and BJP. 25-35.
So the Modi factor in
Congress,
2013.
Congress, cluster in Congress, 2013, and Congress here.
It's the Modi factor which gets combined.
It's the Shivraj factor.
Which
Shivraj
gets combined with the Shivraj
Singh Chauhan
factor.
2013 was not as big as he was in 2013. Look at this. It's all orange. Orange.
Is this Shivraj factor?
No,
or is this Modi factor?
2013 was purely Modi factor.
Modi factor.
Let's compare this to 2014. 47-18. 2014 Lok Sabha, it becomes 56-9. So
exactly.
The point I'm making is by 2013, Shivraj had become a factor.
Shivraj is the perfect base.
The
you
factor
see,
that he was not in 2008. By 2013, he had become. In 2014, it was even bigger a factor because Modi had come into the picture.
Exactly.
So Rashid.
There is now a very important fatigue factor that has set in Rajasthan, in Madhya Pradesh, more pronouncedly, and in
Fatigue against the campaigning, Prime Minister Modi, central government, Shivraj Singh Chauhan.
If you're talking about Shivraj Singh Chauhan, same thing, he's been making more and more promises. Whereas people want delivery. On delivery scale, I mean, on the ground level, he's lacking. I know Mr. Bhalla will not agree.
You believe there's a fatigue factor. Pradeep Gupta, I'm looking at your numbers. And again, your numbers also seem to be suggesting that it's a dead heat. I want to understand how is a big state like Madhya Pradesh now being converted into so close as if it could be anyone's game. What's changed in Madhya Pradesh this time around, Pradeep?
Bhupen, there are, I believe, 3-4 factors.
Yes,
one
yes.
is definitely, yes, Shivraj, very, in fact, most popular CM. He himself is fighting with his MLA, which is most unpopular MLAs. That's the one factor. Factor number two, MP is too big a state geographically. So if you go to Nimar, Malwa or Bhopal region, where BJP is clearly leading than the Congress. And if you go to Chambal, Mahakaushal, Bundelkhand, here Congress is leading than the BJP.
So the story
so
is split along regions.
Divide within the Madhya Pradesh.
So there is a regional disparity, you're saying, and that's
and
the reason why this debate is getting
is
so
Congress,
close.
Congress may have to pay. Congress may have to pay haptic for not being aligned with BSP.
For not aligning
had
with the
had there been alliance with the BSP,
the
we would have not
different.
Discussing all this. But that's the reason why the fight is so close, difficult to call one winner at this
you buy
point
that?
Of time.
You buy that, Yashwan?
You must understand.
Alliance with BSP?
Alliance would have been a big thing, no doubt. But in case of Chhattisgarh, yes. MP, I am a bit doubtful because Congress is sweeping in precisely those regions where the BSP presence is there.
So the BSP vote
so BSP
is
vote
moving
if,
to the Congress
if
party.
Vote, exactly. If they would have added to Congress further, probably in Bundelkhand, Bangelkhand and Mahakaushal, the Congress margins would have got much bigger.
Rashid,
but it
would
have
you
been
go
much
back?
Difference
and
in
Yashwan
seats.
Ji, and upper yours
vote.
Is the only poll. Just
and
one second,
upper
class
vote, there would have been
one
a big swing.
Yashwan Ji's is the only poll. Is the only poll which shows others in Madhya Pradesh 6-22. That is a fairly substantial number.
That's
whereas
substantial
other, all
number.
The other polls are within 10.
That's a substantial number. I can give you a precisely makeup. I can give you the precise makeup. There are 5 to 6 BSP seats.
Yes.
There are 2 Samajwadi Party seats. There are 2 GGP seats. There are few independents. So MP is not if yes, we it on the face of it, it looks like it's bipolar. It is bipolar.
But there are regional
but there
stories.
There are regional.
There is a Gondwana Gantantra Party
but
alliance.
One thing which I want to actually suggest, you know, Bhupen, I have requested you many times. You run this a very serious show, and every time I get disappointed when you only and only compare all the seats range of the different agencies.
No, because I want to know.
No, but
I'll tell you why I'm comparing.
If you would have shown the vote share, the product. This is perfect example. I tell
sir,
you why.
You see, you have done the poll, Yashwanji.
I tell
now,
you
if
why.
You say, either you admit that there is a problem with your model, you admit that there is a problem with the model of your votes being converted into seats.
Please try to understand.
You admit that.
All the polls are saying if somebody is saying BJP is leading in MP, if somebody is saying, you will find that lead is hardly about 1%. If somebody is saying Congress is leading,
2%, 1%.
My point is
3%. Okay.
So, can I just say this? Can I just bring in Sanjay also? Yeah.
Because when a pollster has come under a lot of pressure.
That's what I'm trying to get at. When there is a polling agency which tells me actually the Congress's range is between 102 to 116,
yeah,
and the BJP's range is between 108 to 120, because as a viewer, I'm slightly confused.
Because then I want to know who's really, is there a problem, Sanjay ji?
Is there a problem? Is there a problem with sampling? Is there a problem with vote conversion into seats? Is that a fundamental debate here?
I would like to use a different word than problem. I would say it's challenging. Converting votes into seats is always challenging. And it, as we have been discussing this time and again, it's about concentration of votes and spread of votes. If your votes are spread out, you're likely to win more seats. Vice versa also. So it's about challenging to convert votes into seats. I won't say it's a problem.
Okay. In Gujarat, Bhupen, 8% lead of the BJP, and what was the difference between seats of the Gujarat
as
and the
citizen,
BJP and the
as
Congress?
A citizen of India, when I see an exit poll, when I see some numbers coming up, I'd like to know how. I'd like to know what is the big picture. Yeah. So Zaka, let's move on to the next state. The state of Rajasthan. Unlike Madhya Pradesh, there is near consensus. I think hardly, other than Surjit Bhalla, who's giving a straightforward victory to the Bharatiya Janata Party, maybe one more. I don't think there's any other poll which is suggesting that Vasundhara Raje is coming back. What's the problem? What's so easy to pick up in the state of Rajasthan, which is not so easy to pick up in states like Madhya Pradesh?
It's a bellwether and it swings. This plus 6% or plus 7%, look at this. This is a 12% vote share difference. So if Congress is to beat BJP in 2018, they have to have a plus 6%. And that's happened in Rajasthan. It's not like it's impossible. This is where it's going to change. This is the southern belt. This is Mewar, Chittorgarh, Pratapgarh, Rajsamand, so on. This is 2013. Sea of orange. I'm going to highlight just the BJP seats. They won 31 out of 35. Just a sea of saffron. In 2008, 5 years ago, it was the exact opposite story. 24 out of those 35 seats, Congress won. Sea of saffron becomes a sea of blue. This is the Rajput factor. This is where the game will change as far as the state of Rajasthan is concerned. And the Rajputs have been unhappy with Vasundhara for a whole host of reasons.
Is there, like, just like Shivraj Singh Chauhan is the single most important factor and everyone agrees with it as far as Madhya Pradesh is concerned. Yashwanji, is Vasundhara Raje's so-called unpopularity the most important factor in Rajasthan?
Unfortunately, yes. Because there are plenty of people who genuinely believe that she has done quite a substantial work on the macroeconomics. I mean, we might be agreeing on that one. But the thing is that when you talk to people, when we construct our questionnaire, we do map, at different level where exactly the anger is being aimed at. So while in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, we see the maximum anger is aimed at against the sitting MLAs or the ministers, but not the chief minister. The pyramid is upside down in the case of Rajasthan. When you ask them,
the chief minister herself is important.
Exactly.
So in Madhya Pradesh, chief minister is popular, Sanjay ji. But in Rajasthan, chief minister is unpopular.
That is why, Bhupen, you see, while it is possible, it's quite possible that all the polls may go wrong in Rajasthan. And but that's the reason that you see some kind of a consensus among all the polls. And the reason is that there is a widespread unpopularity of the sitting chief minister.
Surjit Bhalla, do you agree?
In Madhya Pradesh, differences of opinion because
the problem with Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh is that Raman Singh and Shivraj both are popular.
So Raman Singh, Shivraj Singh Chauhan popular. Vasundhara Raje unpopular. Therefore, straightforward
result. The CM is unpopular. MLA is unpopular.
Let's hear Surjit say.
Go back to, with everybody's permission, to Madhya Pradesh for just 1 minute. We were talking about BSP. We were talking about the fact that this is a very, very tight race, 1 or 2 percentage points. And the BSP got 6.3% of the vote the last time.
Right.
Now, I ask you, and we need to ask all of us, is the BSP voter likely to vote for
the Congress?
For the Congress.
Or for the BJP.
Or for the BJP. I think all our priors, prior to the exit polls, would have been that they are much more likely to vote for the Congress. That's a general assumption.
Unfortunately.
Unless something has radically changed in the last 1 month.
Okay.
Therefore, I think that's the difference between my
your understanding
and
in their calculations.
As far as Madhya Pradesh is concerned.
Rajasthan?
No, Rajasthan.
Do you agree? Sanjay Kumar and Yashwant Deshmukh say she's unpopular.
Yeah.
And therefore the BJP is paying a price.
You know, when she was running in 2014, when she was running in 2013, she was not running in 2014, but the BJP was running. I heard the same things, that she's unpopular. And that there's a lot of infighting, the BJP high order doesn't like her, everything else.
By election results,
yes.
And the way Prime Minister Narendra Modi has campaigned.
Three Lok Sabha bipoles were lost by the BJP in Rajasthan in the last 12 months.
Prime Minister was leading the campaign.
In places like Alwar, Ajmer, where the BJP had won in 2014 by almost 3 lakh votes, that vote share got shrunk by 1.5 lakh votes. That's the statement we're talking about. So why is Sanjay Kumar and Yashwant Ji wrong?
I'm different than all of them as far as Rajasthan is concerned. I don't think the popularity, etc., of an individual leader matters as much. It matters, but doesn't matter as much as what they have done, what they have delivered. And I do think, and the data shows that the BJP government or Vasundhara Raj's government in Rajasthan has delivered a lot to the bottom 70%.
Bottom 70%. Can I just go to Zaka on that one? Because I think it's important. Zaka, just take us through the Vasundhara Raj factor in Rajasthan. You were talking about the Rajput factor. Vasundhara Raj herself?
So this is Alwar and Ajmer. This is 2013. BJP had a 15% lead in Alwar and Ajmer. And in 2018, both those Lok Sabha seats, they lost about one lakh plus votes.
1 lakh plus votes.
That's so this is 2013.
So maybe that was a teaser. 2008.
That's bipolar, 2008. Look at the difference. It's much closer. The vote share is exactly the same. 36%, 36%. Congress getting a cluster of seats both in Ajmer as well as in Alwar. Let's go to the Vasundhara Raje factor. Vasundhara Raje factor, of course. And here's the interesting thing about Vasundhara Raje. The interesting thing is that unlike Shivraj Singh Chauhan, take a look at this. She's influential in about 30-odd seats. In 2013, 38 seats. In fact, that's closer to 40. Vote share difference of 17%. This is Jalrapatan. This is in Jalawar. She has no influence in any of these constituencies in the Kota southeastern belt of Rajasthan. She has influence in the central sort of heartland of Rajasthan. This is 2013. BJP wins 38 of those seats. 2008... It's blue here.
Sujit, where do you believe the pollsters, according to you, have got it wrong?
I do not look at caste. I've looked at caste until, the blood has come out from my eyes and I can't find anything.
You can't find anything. You don't see there is any anti-incumbency against Vasundhara Raje.
Explain the caste factor a little bit. Please tell me, and I'm asking all of you, the caste composition, to the best of my knowledge, in any state hasn't changed much. But the governments have changed so much. How is this the same person was voting for X and now voting for Y?
Pradeep Gupta, answer Sujit Balla. How is it that some say that Vasundhara Raje is so unpopular, but if caste combinations have not changed, how is it that each election we're saying one caste, the Rajput community, suddenly moving away from the BJP?
Generally, as per our study, 50% of the voters of any states are more or less aligned or loyal to one or the other party. It is other 50%, and other 50%, when I say, the large chunks comes from the lower strata group, which is generally represented by ST, SCs, OBCs, MBCs, and Muslims.
And Surjit Malla's argument is that quota.
One moment. On the performance Pradeep, of the existing
Pradeep,
government.
Can I just ask you to hold on? Because I think you make an important point. Exactly the community you're talking about, according to Mr. Bhalla, that this section, the poorest of the poor, is all moving towards the Bharatiya Janata Party.
Not all because moving, of delivery. But they have benefited enormously
Not at all.
One last point. Take into account anti-incumbency, etc. The BJP won 163 seats last time.
Right.
I'm saying they win only 115. So they're not all moving.
Right.
I'm saying to one third.
You are not
of the
seeing
entire,
this decisive move away from the BJP.
Because it was such a huge victory last
time. So the delta is so high.
You need to repeat what the delta. You need to repeat, or the Congress needs to repeat, what BJP got from Babri Masjid.
Pradeep Gupta.
Please tell me what has happened in the last 5 years.
Pradeep Gupta.
Equivalent to Babri Masjid.
Pradeep Gupta. Pradeep.
No, I don't know about Babri Masjid in my poll at this juncture. But what is most important in our poll study has come out is definitely OBCs, barring Jat, general caste, which includes Brahmins, Baniya, and Srivastav and Lala's type, is voting in favor of BJP. But whereas this comes to SC, ST and Muslims, they are largely this time in Rajasthan voting for Congress.
So therefore,
Muslims were always voting for the government, but the SCs and STs.
That's not a fact. SCs and STs. Yeah. Would I be right, therefore, Sanjayji, to say that actually what is happening, what's now happening is that the movement of some communities, the bottom of the pyramid communities, which perhaps happened towards the BJP in large parts, let's say the tribal community in places like Chhattisgarh, the scheduled tribes, the Ahirs, the Telis, maybe because of Narendra Modi's presence, that movement now is getting reversed and is going back to the Congress party. Would that be a correct way to read the situation?
Yes, I think if you look at the two best elections of BJP before 2014, which is 98 and 99.
Right.
These are the two elections when which BJP won at the national level because of its core support. And I think BJP managed to win the 2014 elections and an election before that, 2013 assembly election. And most of the assembly elections after 2014 because BJP managed to get plus core supporters. And plus core supporters are the communities which you mentioned. I think we are seeing a movement of these communities again.
Away from the BJP.
The reversal.
Reversal.
I would agree that reversal doesn't mean all those who shifted to BJP in 2014. All of them have
but Yashwanji,
shifted.
Yashwanji, look at what Zaga has.
We all agree on the reversal, mind you. We all agree on the reversal.
But it's a degree.
That's why the vote.
But you said the degree. Look at. You know, Zaga has an interesting story to tell us. And this is the Dalit-dominated story in Rajasthan.
So since we're
talking about the Dalit factor, how have Dalits voted in favor or against
the BJP? There are 27 seats out of 200 where Dalits are dominant. Many of these are reserved constituencies. BJP won 23 out of those 27 in 2013. Now, what I want to do is to add another filter to this. In these 27 seats, how many seats has the BJP dropped its sitting MLA? You only drop a sitting MLA when you feel that there is great amount of anti-incumbency. 15 out of 27, that's more than half of those seats, the BJP has dropped its sitting MLA. Constituency number 77, Baseri Reserve Constituency, sitting MLA dropped.
So Yashwanji, is it going to work?
Bayana,
Yashwanji, is it going to
work? The reason why they dropped those sitting MLAs is because there's a problem.
I think we know this.
Nationally, what has happened is the anger on the SCST Act, the Supreme Court ruling, the government then sort of bringing in an amendment in Parliament, that has caused something in the Dalit communities, certainly in Rajasthan,
that's forced the BJP
to drop its sitting MLAs. Otherwise,
Which is all the more reason why the BSP, in Rajasthan, they're not so much. Why you can't ignore the BSP in Madhya Pradesh. So you can't have it both ways. The Dalit anger is there.
No,
but if the Dalits are angry,
Vasundhara Raja drops
the
MLAs.
But there's a basic difference
in the Dalit vote. BSP is 2 or 3%
I was trying to tell. I mean, it is an interesting composition. Dropping the MLAs definitely works in cutting down the anti-incumbency, provided there is no anger against the sitting chief minister.
So it may work in Madhya Pradesh.
It may work in Madhya Pradesh, but not in Rajasthan.
In
Chhattisgarh.
Okay.
Unlikely to work in Rajasthan.
Okay.
All right. That's a moot point. Another thing, Dr. Bhalla, actually, when he said that, you know, from how much can really BJP drop? You know, okay, 160 plus 215. How much? Dr. Bhalla, just remember, Buddhadev Bhattacharya got the largest possible mandate in the entire 30-year rule of CPM in West Bengal. But when within 5 years he lost...
When it rains, it really pours.
It always happens.
When it rains, it really pours.
He lost his own seat. From getting the highest possible mandate to the lowest possible mandate just happened within five years.
Okay. Anger.
Let's look at the story of Chhattisgarh.
He is saying that anger is not visible. I agree that anger is not visible.
Against Vasundhara Raja? Now, what is this argument?
No, no, no. That is Prime Minister campaigning for the same amount of anger. Why did Prime Minister if he is giving the example of West Bengal?
You know, Rashid has a good point. Let's look at all election campaigns since 2014. The two election campaigns where this duo of Amit Shah and Narendra Modi failed to fire was in Bihar and in Delhi. And look at what happens in Bihar also. Now again, the BJP's business. I'm saying when Prime Minister is campaigning till 4:30 p.m. on last year of campaigning in Rajasthan, am I to understand that the Prime Minister does not know that he's campaigning in a state where the Chief Minister is so unpopular?
There is a reason.
What is the reason?
You see, in the tracker, 3 months back, the Congress was running away with almost 15-16% gap.
So the Modi factor has pulled the Congress down.
Brought it down to 4%, 5% in the polls.
Surjit doesn't buy that. We have been tracking it.
Second thing.
All the opinion polls, and I mentioned it the other day, all the opinion polls had a 2-to-1 margin in favor of the Congress prior to all of this.
2 months ago, it was 2-1. And yesterday, when you guys
came
up,
they saying from 16%, it has
that's what I'm saying.
Oh, that Prime Minister brought that margin really reduced a lot. Now,
so
second thing.
Not
second thing.
In the same poll,
we have been saying, when we asked the same respondent if there was a Lok Sabha election today, whom you would have voted for, that's a thumping vote for Modi.
Still vote.
Thumping vote for Modi, the same sample.
I want to look at Chhattisgarh and Telangana quickly, and then we'll come to this question that should we be reading that number, 311, should we be reading that number as some kind of a referendum as we move towards 2019? Why is the story of Chhattisgarh and the story of Telangana? Let's focus on Chhattisgarh once. Is Chhattisgarh too close to call, gentlemen?
Is
Chhattisgarh straightforward?
Please show the vote share. You know what, Bhupen? 0.5% lead of the Congress. 0.5%.
It can
bring in any damn poster under the sun over here. Gallup sahab ki atma ko bula karke yahan baitha lijiye aur unse boliye ki Hindustan mein.
So Balla sahab, then why do you say Balla sahab that even in Chhattisgarh the story is completely BJP dominated?
39-45. That's about as close as you can get.
It's a 90-member assembly,
it's the third-party factor.
Let's look at that. Zaka's got that on the wall. For the first time, we're now seeing the entry of a third player in this election.
Yeah. So,
how is that impacting this
election? So, if Maya and Jogi were aligned in 2013, the Congress would have won 19 of those seats and the BJP would have won 20. Now, a bulk of these seats, there's a lot of commonalities here. A bulk of these seats would be, for example, in the Naxal Belt. This is Sukma. This was won by the Congress. This is Bastar, again won by the Congress. This is Chitrakoot, won by the Congress. This is Dantewada, won by the Congress. Now, this is 2013. In 2008, it was the exact opposite picture. The same Naxal Belt, BJP won big, 24-15. The same bunch of seats, BJP won. The problem is in Chhattisgarh, I'm not sure any of the pollsters are able to confidently say whose vote Maya and Jogi will eat.
Pradeep, is that not a valid question to pose?
Yes.
Because I look at all elections post 2014 and I see in major states, in Gujarat, Karnataka, Maharashtra, certainly in Uttar Pradesh, even in parts of Bihar, there was a movement of this Dalit vote, of the tribal vote towards the Bharatiya Janata Party. With the entry of this third player now in Chhattisgarh, Is there a problem with that vote, Pradeep ji?
Yeah, Bhupen, you are right. But when it comes to Chhattisgarh and particularly with Ajit Jogi and BSP factor, it is limited only to Bilaspur, Jhanjgir Chapa, Mungveli, Baloda Bazar district, and that's it. Out of those 27 districts in this state, that's the problem.
So you don't think that this is something
all
which
they are denting,
this is not something
gaining,
which can impact. You don't think that this is something which will impact the ultimate result?
Definitely, Congress is going to with a thumping majority, as our poll suggests, between 55 to 65 seats for sure.
55 to 65 seats. Sanjay ji, is that your viewpoint
and
as well?
He's had it for sure.
Sanjay ji. Small state, three players.
No, that's not my viewpoint. The poll which we conducted, our poll suggests that Congress is cutting into, Jogi is cutting into the Congress support base and they are getting roughly about 10-12% vote, Jogi and BSP together.
10-12% vote.
11% in my poll.
That's a lot of vote.
And that is damaging. BJP's vote share is there, what it was in 2013. So what is happening is that Congress vote is getting split between Congress and Jogi factor, and that is hurting the Congress to a great extent. And my own sense is BJP is going to win.
BJP may end up winning the state of Chhattisgarh.
My sense is that it is vote share wise, it is too close to call, honestly. But in our numbers, we have been definitely sensing a fatigue factor.
It's a complete fatigue factor.
Let me tell you again, it is no anger against the sitting chief minister. Can I just put it this way?
And one thing
which I was just wanted to, you know, when you were mentioning about the southern part of it, you raised a question whether the pollsters are really sure about what is going to happen. Absolutely unsure, but not because of Jogi. Jogi is a big zero over there. Let me tell you. I tell you why we are unsure. 90% of that southern part of that territory, forget about posters, even security personnel
will not go.
I'm raising my
Mahindra
hand.
Karma
we
ended up paying
the people,
with their lives.
But the researchers can gain access to
only certain
secure
parts.
Town part of those places.
Sure. Okay.
And these places have swung. You have shown from Congress to BJP to Congress. So all I can say
that probably if BJP, according to Sanjay ji, might get an edge, it would be because the local incumbency against the sitting MLA, because Congress is holding maximum number of MLA.
Have the exit pollsters really given us a clear picture of what can we expect on the 11th? And you've seen, despite the confusion, there are some strands which you can pick up. And those strands, those threads need to be looked out for when the voting actually takes place on the 11th. Let me toss it across to Anand Narasimhan then and get a sense as to how will the story of state assembly, how will it really end up impacting the Lok Sabha elections in 2019, Anand?
Well, let's keep the factor of Narendra Modi out, Bhupen Chaubey, and let's just look at the numbers. Let's just look at the hard numbers over the last three assembly and Lok Sabha elections, and we'll start with the state of Madhya Pradesh. And as we call up the Madhya Pradesh data, 2003-2004, as the numbers pop up here, you will see there is a trend, there is a pattern. Look at the numbers in 2003. In 2003, you have Shivraj Singh Chauhan taking 173 of the 230 seats. And look what happens in 2004. In 2004, he's got a whopping 25 out of the 29 seats. The Congress had 38 seats and it pinched about four. Then you look at this number here, 2008-2009. Irrespective of who formed the government at the center, this is what Shivraj Singh and Madhya Pradesh contributed to the BJP. It's a good 9 seats down. Why? Because they lost 30 seats between 2003 and 2008 assembly elections, polling only 143. The Congress surging to 71 and they reaped the benefits of the Lok Sabha. Look at what happens in 2013-2014. In 2013-2014, the number surges forward, surges upwards for Shivraj Singh Chauhan, 165, 58 for the Congress, and 2014, that's the Modi effect, 27 and 2. But Shivraj Singh Chauhan, when he has numbers upward of about 145 or 150 seats, 150 plus seats means he's comfortable. The BJP this time can defend the 27 seats. But if it hangs around somewhere around 125 to 130 seats, we are looking at a 2008-2009 kind of scenario where the BJP will be at least minus 10 Lok Sabha seats, cutting out, keeping the Modi factor out as far as Lok Sabha is concerned. Quickly, as far as Rajasthan. In Rajasthan, the trend is very, very similar. It has the habit of voting out the incumbent and then perhaps rewarding them too as far as Lok Sabha is concerned. Look at the 2003-2004 number. Let me just bring it into perspective. 2003-2004, 120 seats for the BJP, and there you have 56 for the Congress party. And look at the benefits that they reap. The benefits they reap are 21 and 4 out of 25. Then in 2008-2009, the Congress didn't touch 100 as far as the assembly seats is concerned. It got only 96, but it reaped the benefit as far as Lok Sabha, 20 out of the 25. Look at the swing which happened as far as Lok Sabha is concerned between the Congress and the BJP. Then 2013-2014, as we call up the 2013-2014 number, look at it. Vasundhara Raje surges. Many say it is because of Modi, but it's a 25-0 score, the best ever for the BJP from that state that has happened. This is what we could see if the Congress comes back, and even if it gets the majority number, past the 100 mark, if it gets to 105 seats, we could see a significant impact as far as Lok Sabha Rajasthan is concerned. In Chhattisgarh, the score has been very, very interesting. In Chhattisgarh, the score has always been 10-1 as far as Lok Sabha is concerned. But Raman Singh has been losing. There's been attrition, one seat per assembly election, and the Congress party has been gaining one seat per assembly election. And if you quickly look at these numbers, from 50-37 and 10-1, 50-38, 10-1, and 49-39, 10-1. So if this time Raman Singh is at 46, will there be an attrition as far as Lok Sabha is concerned? Overall, we are looking at the BJP going at least 25-30 seats minus between these three states. Right now, they have 63 out of the 83 Lok Sabha seats, and about 52, if you were to look at it, 25, 27, 52 and 10, 62 seats out of the 70 odd from these three states itself. That's the big question. That's the big question, Bhupen. How much they will have, will they have to make up to get back to 272? They're at 269 now.
Right.
They were 282 in 2014. They're 269 now. Minus around 20, 25 seats here.
Right.
They will feel the pressure, Bhupen.
And the Congress is hoping that they will make the game even more difficult for the Bharatiya Janata Party by getting into statewide alliances. One of the states this time around, which is going to poll the state of Telangana, where the story of alliance is actually being put in experiment is Telangana. This alliance, Dhaka, which has been worked out between the TDP and the Congress and both sides being very, very optimistic about it. How is it actually impacting the story of Telangana?
So, there was no Kutumi in 2014. Now there is a Praja Kutumi, and already they have a 6% lead, 40% to 34% of the TRS, and yet a majority of the polls seem to be suggesting that the TRS is in pole position. At least the majority of the polls are predicting that
barring
the TRS will win.
Yashwant Deshmukh believes that it's the other way
around. Everybody else is predicting TRS will win. These are 25 constituencies where Andhra settlers are important. The TDP has fielded about a dozen odd candidates, all of them within these 25 seats. Now, this 25 also includes the 8 cities. These green patches that you see, these green patches are the 8 cities inside Old City of Hyderabad where the MIM is contesting. So, there's an informal understanding between MIM and TRS in these 8 seats. And here, there is the Kutumi. Outside of this, the TDP is not as much a factor in terms of the candidates. A bulk of their candidates are here in the greater Hyderabad region, which is why in the last week of campaigning, you had Owaisi telling, Yogi telling Owaisi, you have to run away.
I'll throw you out.
And then KCR stepping up the Telangana pride factor was because of this.
So let's just put up the big picture for you. If this is the story across all these poll-bound states, what does it all boil down to? If you were to work out an average. Now, there is no model behind this. This is a straightforward mathematical analysis which has been done. Poll of polls, what is it suggesting for the state of Madhya Pradesh? It suggests just a slight edge, a one-seat difference as far as the Bharatiya Janata Party. There you have it. As far as the BJP is concerned. So, tilted towards the BJP, 4 seats there with the BSP, 9 others, including many of those rebels who've been backed by the BJP itself.
Nobody gets majority.
What's the story of Rajasthan? Congress Party, comfortable majority, 113. In a house of 200. What's the next state? The state of Chhattisgarh and Telangana. What's happening there? The broad consensus, the big picture, if you look at all these polls, is this, that in Chhattisgarh, again, the Congress may well end up crossing the halfway mark. And finally, then the state of Telangana, where there was near consensus that the TRS was going to come back. Polo poll seems to suggest that indeed TRS was going to come back. And then you have that small state, and I keep forgetting about it, the state of Mizoram, but let's not forget about it. Important state where the Congress has been in power for so long, it appears that the Congress may well end up getting a hit there as well. All this then takes us to one simple question, which is that nationally 2019, I want to begin with you, Sanjay ji, whatever happens this time around, is it really going to hold on till 2019? Even if the BJP was to lose a couple of states, will it extrapolate at the Lok Sabha level?
No, if BJP loses a couple of states, I think this will give a moral boost to the Congress and the regional party. They are all holding a meeting tomorrow. If the results are the way you have suggested, that BJP losing a couple of states, I think there will be a movement in the direction of they forming an alliance, trying to have a better understanding compared to what we have seen.
Does Narendra Modi have reasons to worry, Yashwant?
I don't really think so. I mean, I believe that within the same data, if the Lok Sabha voting intention question is giving diametrically opposite results, I have a reason to believe that India has been giving a split vote earlier and is heading for another split vote. They are going to vote differently at the Lok Sabha.
And Surjit Bhalla, will your mathematical model basically say that in 2019, it is simply going to be a clean verdict for Narendra Modi for a second?
Well, and let's assume that the Congress wins 2 states. Even with that assumption, and we've already shown that, look, maybe in Madhya Pradesh and in Rajasthan, they lose about 20 seats.
Right.
And they're already down to, 269? So they're down to 249. And let us add, just for purposes of argument, another 20 seats in UP. You're still at 229.
So you're
and
still
they will gain.
UP is not going to hold up at 20.
In the east,
Rashid.
They will gain in elsewhere.
Quick final point, Rashid.
So I think,
very quick point. I think this 5th round of assembly election is all about Congress and Rahul Gandhi. If Congress wins 2 states, defeating BJP in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, it will have or Rajasthan for that matter, it will have a huge psychological impact. It will shake the BJP because it will be the first time that Congress will be defeating BJP.
I just want to remind all of you decisively. What had happened in 2003 when this round of assembly elections happened. Chhattisgarh went to the BJP, Madhya Pradesh went to the BJP, Rajasthan did not go to the BJP. But what happened? Ultimately, in 2004, the BJP lost the election. Now, with Narendra Modi in power, Narendra Modi factor looming so heavily across the length and breadth of India, how will this round of assembly elections leverage or measure up to the impact that Narendra Modi had? I think that's the question which we'll certainly try and answer on the 11th of this month. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us on this Power Packed edition. Counting day, that's on 11th. Exactly 48 hours from now. Less than 48 hours from now, we will know who's winning this big semi-final match of 2018. See you then.
अरे तू क्या तेरी हैसियत क्या तेरी दिमाग क्या